The good life. What does it look like? How do we find it? Is it wealth? Health? Good looks? Looking younger? Free time? Friends? Is it just more? Tony Bennett sang, "Oh, the good life, full of fun, seems to be the ideal." He's a much better singer than I. Sorry about that. The good life lets you hide all the sadness you feel. Sorry, thank you. Oh, it's good to be back. Thank you. Where was I? Many of us are searching for it. Advertisers try to show us what it looks like. From houses to vacations, whiskey to women, the right car, the right job. But do they really give us the good life that we're looking for? I've been trying to figure this out lately. I see a lot of people on social media living their best life. It certainly looks so much better than mine. Compared to them, I don't live my life. I tolerate it. So I don't have too many things that I could post. I just browse other people's pages and live through them vicariously. I don't have any social media accounts of my own, unless we can count email. Does that count? Occasional facts. I do have Pinterest, but you guys familiar with Pinterest on the internet? So I'll pin things that I like, clothes, cars, gourmet food, hairstyles. Lots of cool stuff. And I don't mean to brag, but I will. Several times, the people at Pinterest organization have reached out to me and told me that I have a good eye and that I am an inspiration. So, I like that. I'll be honest. I want things that would give me what the kids nowadays call Raz. You guys heard that term, or is it the Raz? I have a couple teenagers, and I hear them and their friends use that vernacular, which I'm pretty sure is slang for the old razzle-dazzle. And who doesn't want a little razzle and dazzle in their life? Am I right, young people? I know I do. I have a friend, strange but true. His name is Dave. He's in his 80s now. And anytime Sarah and I would visit my parents in Southwest Florida, we try to get together with Dave. He has a way of making us feel important, special. For several decades, he worked in finance, wealth management, and many of his clients were very well off. We'd be out and he'd point out one of his clients' homes and I'd say, "That's a house? I thought that was a resort. Can we stop at the gift shop?" By all accounts, they appear to be living the good life. He told me once that many of them lived lives of immense success, but few lived lives of significance. Dave was and is a believer, a Christ follower, so I knew what he meant by that statement. What he meant was this: they had climbed the ladder of success only to get to the top and discover that the ladder was leaning against the wrong wall. It should be a good life, but without Jesus, it wasn't. Dave has a gift for sharing his faith, just so natural. But he led several clients and his friends to follow Jesus as well, beyond success, to a life of significance. This morning and next week, Pastor Rod is going to share a message titled, "The Good Way to Live." And the good life that God has planned for us in the life to come is something we can actually start living today. The way to truly discover the good life is by finding what the Apostle Paul describes as the good way to live. Oh, the good life.
Oh, the good life, full of fun, seems to be the ideal. The good life lets you hide all the sadness.
Tony Bennett. I want to thank Dave, of course, for his version, but we appreciated Tony's a little bit more there. No, my thanks to Dave, especially for all of his commentaries that he's been bringing during the series. I think they've really lightened it up and also given us great insight. And also my thanks to Tony Bennett. That one, by the way, is a duet with Billy Joel. So if you want to look that one up, Tony Bennett Duets, it's a great album. Anyway, our present series, we've been attempting to answer this question. And the question we've been attempting to answer is simply this: what does the good place Jesus intended the church to be actually look like? What does it look like? And we've been searching for the answer by exploring a letter the Apostle Paul wrote to a young pastor on the island of Crete. In the letter, known in the New Testament as the book of Titus, the Apostle Paul writes to Titus, and he shares with him these ideas, these principles about what a good church is and what you'll find in actually when a church becomes a good place. And so today, what we're going to see is that Paul tells Titus, the members of a church that is a good place will be living this good life. They'll be living the good way to live. That's what he's going to concentrate on in the letter, in what we're looking at this week, and we're going to look at part two next week, that people in the church, people that are in a good place, that is a church, will be living a good way to live. They'll be living this good life. Interestingly, when Paul describes the good way to live, it looks quite different than the so-called good life that many people seem to be searching for. Even Tony's song starts out as Dave said, "Oh, the good life, full of fun," seems to be the idea. The good life lets you hide all the sadness you feel. What a line. I suspect there are a lot of people who have spent their lives pursuing the good life, but have found it just being the sadness, or a cover, or a hide for the sadness they feel. There was a time a few years ago when I would ask people a question, it would seem to be a popular response, when I would just say, "So, how are you doing? How's it going?" And some would respond this way, it was mostly men, they would say, "I'm just living the life. I mean, I'm living the dream, Rod." That's what they'd say. "I'm living the dream, Rod. I'm just living the dream." And I always smiled at that. Now, maybe you've said it. Maybe you meant it because, you know, you're living the dream. You actually are living the way you want to live. But I think most of the people who said that to me, and I knew them well enough to know that they were saying that tongue-in-cheek. They were saying it seriously, but they didn't really mean it. They were not living the dream. Now, to be clear, there is no reason, when we read Titus, there is no reason not to pursue the good life. There's nothing in Titus that says you shouldn't pursue it. And so I think we need to keep that in mind. But let's be honest, we're not sure we've all found it. You know, we work at it, as Dave was talking about, different ways we try to get it. And we certainly all want the good life. So there's no evidence in the letter to Titus that you shouldn't pursue it. And there's no evidence in this letter to Titus that somehow Paul is against the good life. So going after the good life is not the problem. Finding the true good life, or the good way to live, is the challenge. And here we see that Paul has a different view than most on what the good life really is. And so after telling Titus that the church is a good place, as a good place, has a good message, that was week one. Week two, the church as a good place has good leaders. The church as a good place rejects the good lie. And last week, the church as a good place works to have good homes. Paul then says to that members of churches that are good places, the kind that Jesus wants them to be, know the good way to live begins not when they win the lottery, not when they retire, not when they get married, not when they get a promotion, not when they get the new house or the new car or the new cabin, not when they get the right government in power, not when they get a third wave coffee shop in Eagan, although that would be great, but that doesn't happen then. No, Paul tells Titus that the first step in experiencing the good way to live is recognizing this, that you live in a different kingdom with different rules. So you would think that's not where it would start. But what he's saying is, first of all, if you want to really find the good way to live or find the good life, You have to change your perspective. You have to change your perspective. It doesn't have to do with possessions. It doesn't really have to do with politics. It has to do with changing your perspective. So take a look at Titus 2:11. For the remarkable, undeserved grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Here Paul reminds Titus that when Jesus appeared to all men, the kingdom of God was established on the earth. This is a big one. Since that time, when Jesus came and established the kingdom of God on the earth, that kingdom of God has been slowly growing, but has not yet fully come. So, those of us who follow Jesus, we live in this tension of what's known as the now and not yet. Kingdom of God has come, but it's not fully known yet. And we live in that tension right now. I've been trying to think, well, how do we illustrate this? Because a lot of times it's hard to really comprehend this and get this. And I found what might be a pretty good illustration of this. It's in a novel, Death Comes for the Destructionist by Daniel Taylor. And I think he gives a great illustration of the now or the already but not yet. And the story goes like this. In the novel, the author describes Judy eating a hot dog. Okay? Imagine that. He writes, Judy sits across the small galley table, slowly chewing a hot dog on a fork that she holds up close to her face. She takes a bite and then stares at the end of the hot dog while she chews, slowly but inexorably, okay, yeah, that's easy to say, inexorably, balanced between the pleasure of the hot dog in her mouth and the anticipation of the next bite to come. A perfect illustration of now and not yet. The once, but also future, hot dog. Now you'd say that's a weird one. You know, it is summer. Summer's coming. I hope you like hot dogs, all beef, no fillers. But here's where the good way to live starts, folks, when we understand that those who follow Jesus get to live in the once, right now, and future kingdom of God. We get to live with the privilege of following Jesus today in our life now. We also live anticipating the day Jesus returns and when he fully restores his kingdom on the earth. So Paul writes to Titus and says, the members of a church that is a good place, because that's what we're after. We're trying to figure out what is when a church is a good place, the place Jesus wants it to be, what's it like? And so he says, the members of a church that is a good place will actually live as if they live in the kingdom of God, even while they're physically living in the kingdom of this world. When I was junior high school, into college, Bible college, during that time when I was growing up in those years, there was a ton of emphasis on the second coming of Jesus. This seemed to be about every fourth sermon I heard. There were a lot of books on this, and it was about the second coming of Jesus. And this, of course, is for Christians the blessed hope that we have. I mean, this is something that is one of our doctrines. It's all through the Bible. We live with this blessed hope that one day Jesus will return, or if we pass from this earth, we will get to be with Jesus someday. But unfortunately, what can happen is that we can become so focused on the coming of Jesus that we can ignore our assignment to bring the kingdom of God into this kingdom, to bring the principles and practices of the kingdom of God into the world we live in now. So Paul here then tells Titus, one way to do that is to practice the good way to live. Not necessarily pursue the good life, but the good way to live will bring into this world, will reflect to this world what the kingdom of God is like. And in this particular passage, I'm just going to pull out three things Paul says you practice when you're practicing a good way to live, okay? And the first one he says this way, the good way to live includes sensibility. There's a word, sensibility. Take a look here, Titus 2:12. It teaches us to reject ungodliness and worldly immoral desires and to live sensible, upright, and godly lives, lives with a purpose that reflects spiritual maturity in this present age. And we're going to come back to that word sensible in a minute. Because that's just an interesting word, sensible. Like if somebody said to you, sensible. We're going to come back to that in a minute. But what I want to remind you is this. If you look at that verse, I need you to remember the verse we read just a minute ago. Paul told Titus, and this is important, the grace of God. It's the grace of God that teaches us the good way to live. The grace of God. Some think that the grace of God means we can live any way we want, and then we'll be forgiven, and there will be no consequences for our actions. That's not grace. Others turn grace into like a list of rules that you must keep to live the good life. They work really hard at earning grace, which the Bible says you can't earn because it's a free gift. That's not grace. But here Paul says that when we truly experience grace, that is, the remarkable, undeserved favor of God, it's actually that experience that will teach us the good way to live. Just when we experience grace, just when the grace of God fills our life, the perspective changes. The 1998 film version of Victor Hugo's novel, Les Miserables, I highly recommend it, by the way. Liam Neeson, in that movie, plays Jean Valjean, a man arrested. He was arrested just for stealing food. And he was released 19 years later after being beaten up in a labor camp. When no one is willing to allow this convict to stay the night, he tries to spend the night in a number of places, Bishop Muriel kindly welcomes him into his home. Valjean explains to Bishop Muriel that sleeping in a real bed will make him a new man. Then in the night, Valjean is interrupted by the bishop while he's stealing the bishop's silverware. So Valjean strikes the bishop in the head, and he takes off. The next morning, the police find and arrest Valjean for stealing, drag him back to Bishop Muriel's home, and the police laughingly tell the bishop that Valjean had told them that he, the bishop, had given him this silverware as a gift. Shockingly, Bishop Muriel tells the police, yes, I did give him the silverware as a gift. And then he looks at Valjean and he scolds him. And he says, why didn't you take the candlesticks as well? I told you to take the candlesticks. Valjean cannot believe the bishop's example of grace. He doesn't know what to do with his life. He doesn't know how to live. He had just stolen from this man. He had just beat him. And this man told the police, no, I gave it to him as a gift. In fact, I'm going to scold him right now for not taking these candlesticks. And so Valjean looks at him, and he says, why did you do this? And Bishop Muriel looks at Valjean and says, don't you remember? You promised to become a new man. And then the bishop grabs Valjean by the shoulders, looks him straight in the eyes, and says, this is an awfully moving scene. Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred, and now I give you back to God. This incredible act of grace shown by Bishop Muriel to Jean Valjean teaches him the good way to live. There wasn't any teaching. There wasn't any Bible verses. It was an act of grace. And if you have read the book or seen the movie, you know that his life radically changes because of that act of grace. So look at the verse again. Grace, see it up here? Grace teaches us to reject ungodliness and worldly, immoral desires and to live sensible, upright, and godly lives. Lives with a purpose that reflects spiritual maturity in this present age. So consider just one of the words. I said I'd come back to it. Consider one of the words Paul uses to describe this good way to live, which is sensible. The word sensible is not sexy. Sensible isn't that motivating. It's not like sold out and showy. Grace will teach you how to be sold out. Grace will teach you how to be showy. Sensible never seems to be a compliment. If you're describing a person to a friend and you say, oh, he's or she's a sensible person, you immediately think, they're boring. They're a boring person. But sensible is a powerful word. Another version that translates the word this way, just the word sober. Sober. Think of all the activity that you observe in life that is senseless. It's just silly. I mean, there's nothing wrong with having fun and being goofy. I'm not talking about that. I'm just talking about the senselessness of what some of us do. And here, Paul is saying, when we experience grace, one of the things that will happen in us, we'll learn the good way to live, which will include being sensible. N.T. Wright, in his commentary on this verse about the good way to live, it's about these verses. He writes that these verses that we're looking at today can be summed up in three words. And the first one he says is the word sober or sensible. Here's what he says. This is a quote. You are a real human being. So don't diminish your humanness by drunkenness or other kinds of behavior that makes you more like an irrational animal. You are a creature designed to find fulfillment in being generous and kind to others. Drunkenness and similar behavior results first in your being selfish and then in your being harmful to your own self in turn. End of quote. So God's grace teaches us to be sensible, sober human beings in the way God designed us to be. The good way to live includes living sensibly like a human designed by God to be generous and kind. And that's not boring at all, folks. That's a huge blessing. The good way to live also, it includes sensible or living sensibly, but also it includes expectancy. Titus 2:13, awaiting and confidently expecting the fulfillment of our blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus. The church is a good place, is full of members who live anticipating the return of Jesus someday. So this church that is the good place that Jesus wants it to be will have members who live in anticipation of the second coming of Jesus. I talked a minute ago of just sometimes it becomes the only focus. But that shouldn't mean that we don't anticipate when Jesus will return and establish his kingdom on the earth. In fact, there are three great things about this. One, Christ's personal presence. Can we imagine just being with Christ? Secondly, redemption from our sinful nature. What's that going to be like? And thirdly, restoration of creation. I mean, imagine someday the complete rule of grace and the created order being restored on the earth. What is that going to be like? So living with that blessed hope of Jesus' return actually then fills us with hope and faith right now. So we don't just take that hope and faith and we just look forward to, can't wait, I'll just wait until Jesus comes. It fills us actually with hope right now in the midst of our present troubled world. In fact, a good way to see if you have fully experienced God's grace, if you want to do a little test, you want to see if you've experienced God's grace and if you've embraced the good way to live, is are you full of hope? Are you a hopeful person? That will be a good test. What does the verse say? Awaiting and confidently expecting. We've all met these people who practice this particularly good way of life. They're concerned and burdened for the problems of our world, but they're not filled with fear. And it's not like they don't care about this world. They care deeply. But fear isn't what drives them because they're filled with hope and expectancy. In the midst of college campus violence, artificial intelligence anxiety, wars that don't seem to be ending, including the ongoing culture wars that are continue to bring so much division in our country, what you'll find is those who truly have experienced the grace of God, they'll be practicing the good way to live, by living now as citizens of the kingdom of God, full of hope and expectancy. They will live with hope for the day Jesus will return while sharing that hope and living as an example of that hope in this increasingly hopeless world. So here's the thing, members of the church that is a good place, Jesus intends it to be, experience the good way to live, which includes sensibility and expectancy, so hope. And the last one mentioned in this passage is charity. The good way to live includes charity. Titus 2:14, Jesus, who willingly gave himself to be crucified on our behalf to redeem us and purchase our freedom from all wickedness and to purify for himself a chosen and very special people to be his own possession, get this, who are enthusiastic for doing what is good. They're enthusiastic for doing what is good. The ESV translates, those of you who think that's the only version that the Apostle Paul used, that was a little joke, but anyway, forget it. Okay. No, there are a lot of people that are just big on their version of the Bible, and they're like, this is the only true one. And anyway, this is the ESV, which is a great translation. It says, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. One of the interesting things that has happened, I think, in Christianity and the church is people kind of put down biblical justice. Or you just want to be good to everybody. That's all. You don't want to tell people about sin, or you don't want to tell people they need to be saved. You just want to show kindness. No, that's not it. It's when we understand we can be saved, when we understand we need to be saved by the grace of God, that Paul here says, you know what you're gonna be? You're gonna be zealous for good works. It's just going to be a passion of yours. And I have the word charity here because I think another word for good works is charity. And folks, living the good way to live will definitely practice charity. Again, one more comment. N.T. Wright, in that same commentary on Titus that I referred to, the Christian, this is a quote, the Christian who understands what God's grace is all about, the powerful love which will turn the world the right way up and has begun to do so in Jesus already, will not be able to stand idly by and watch injustice at work. It's just so clear that those who practice the good way to live will not be able to stand idly by and watch injustice at work. It just won't be something we'll be able to do. Now, there are different ways people do this. And so we can't point fingers and say, well, this is the right way, that's the right way, and that's the wrong way. I'll give you some examples. Of course, this is my opinion. But some don't stand idly by getting involved in politics, either running for an office or campaigning for who they believe is the right candidate or expressing their views to politicians about issues they believe are essential. That's the way some people are motivated. And they don't want to sit idly by. They feel they want to do something about that. There are others who don't sit idly by serving and loving those who have been hurt by injustices in our world. That's their passion. And they just want to do, they see the hurt in people's lives. Still others don't sit idly by as they work hard to contribute to the community by leading good companies and good nonprofits or leading churches or community centers or good schools. But for any of us who work to bring justice to our world, or, as N.T. Wright says, any of us who want to turn the world the right way up, we must do it motivated by the love and grace of God and not by our need to show that we're good or prove to somebody or something or to assuage guilt or to feel good about ourselves or to prove our commitment. And folks, none of us who have experienced the grace of God, well, we're not sitting idly by, and we're active, reflecting what the kingdom of God looks like in this world, worldly kingdom that we live in. We must realize, and this is, I think, so important. This was something, actually, this morning I was trying to work on in this idea of the now and not yet. And actually, I was praying with Jim and Nancy over here, and as they were praying for me, I just thought, this is it. I think one of the things we need to realize is in this kingdom, we're dealing with the symptoms of this kingdom. So all the challenges that we see, and when you watch the news, and when you're dealing with these things, we live in this kingdom, this world. It's the one we live in, but you and I are citizens of the kingdom of heaven, which is slowly coming. And what we see around us are the symptoms. And so by the grace of God, because of the grace of God in us, I think God calls us to deal with, in prayer and power and also in action, those symptoms that we see in this world. But what we need to know is ultimate healing comes when Jesus fully brings his kingdom. Because sometimes we think that the ultimate healing is in this politician, or it's in this way to live, or it's in this principle that, and it really ultimately will only come when Jesus comes fully and restores the kingdom of God on the earth. But in the meantime, let's bring healing. Let's bring bandages. Let's tell people about the hope. Let's reflect that kingdom that we're a citizen of to those around us. And God will speak to you about who you are and how you should do it, just like the Lord speaks to me about how I should do that. And here's the thing. Some people spend their lives trying to find the good life, as Dave was talking about. And there are others who find the good way to live, okay? As followers of Jesus, the Apostle Paul says that followers of Jesus find first the good way to live. And finding the good way to live then creates good places, good homes, good churches, good workplaces, good neighborhoods, good relationships, good values. And in the end, everybody who does this discovers that the good life comes when we live the good way to live. And that's what we've been looking for all of our lives, that good way to live. It's what our souls have been longing for. And so let's pray together. Would you bow your heads? And let's pray together today. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today. And when we think about as people who have experienced your grace, we're deeply touched and moved. And we see how it changed our perspective. We see how your grace and your love, your unmerited favor toward us, has changed our perspective on the kingdom of God. Today, Lord, we're a people who are part of this local church. And we want to be a local church, to be the good place. We want this local church, Oak Hills Church, to be the good place you intend it to be. And so I pray that we'd be people who understand and have experienced your grace. I pray that we'd be people who realize we are now part of another kingdom. We're citizens of the kingdom of God, and that when you came, you established that kingdom on the earth. And I pray that we'd leave this place today realizing that we can reflect that kingdom. We can show what life is like in that kingdom by our words and by our actions and by our hearts and by our attitudes. We can reflect that to people who are looking for the good life. And I pray, Lord, that today my heart goes for everybody who's in this place and everybody's watching online. You've made us, you've designed us, you've given us unique personalities. You created us this way. And we get to show charity within those personalities, infused by your Holy Spirit. And I pray that today's your Holy Spirit would speak to every one of us. And we'd find that place of reflecting your kingdom through that charity and through that personality you've given each of us. Even right at this moment, I just pray that you would encourage us as a church to be who we are and to walk in that way, in the way you've designed us. And in doing that, people are noticing your grace and your kingdom. And so, Lord, we humbly pray this and ask this today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I always like to end a sermon by inviting you to come to pray. And I think part of it is because, for me, I look forward to approaching, just going to be with whatever team is on in the morning. And I find that there's great strength when I'm going to preach a sermon. There's great strength when I just go ask that couple to just pray for me. Would you pray for me today? And there's power in more people coming together and having another person of faith just speak words in prayer. That's the way God designed us to be when we gather with other people. And so today, if you need prayer, there's something happening in your life. You came in here with a burden. You need prayer for healing. You got some news this week that's shaken, your life's been shaken. If today you just want to walk closer to Jesus, you want to find the way to live the good life, whatever it is, take just a few minutes and come down and let Jim and Nancy pray with you today. And it'll be a blessing to you. Just take a few minutes and wait and let them pray with you today, okay? If you can't do that, just go to our website, go to Connect, Prayer and Care, and then we'll pray for you this week. We always pray for everybody who turns in a prayer request. And so we'll do that for you this week. If you're newer to church, if you're here today and you're just checking out Christianity, or you're wondering about what church is like, you want to know what it means to follow Jesus, there's a page on our website called Follow Jesus. And I want to encourage you to go there. I also want to encourage you to just take a Bible you'll find on the welcome table out there. Begin reading one of the first four books of the New Testament. And that's a great way to get started and to find out more all about it. Next week, we're going to just continue in this series, The Good Way to Live, Part 2. There's another part here that Paul brings in, which is so powerful in walking in the good way to live. And so I hope you'll be with us next week. And we're just going to hang out a few minutes. There's coffee, and we can have some community in the big room. And so we'll see you in there. God bless you. We'll see you.